for coming. I've been doing this lecture for several times, and usually what I learn from those experiences is when I say I'm going to do econ lectures, it scares people away rather than attracts them. It's true. But regardless, we still have like, what, 30-ish people, I've been told, and 4 people on the way, so thank you for coming up. So I'll try my best to keep this lecture as exciting as possible. Right, so as an introduction, before that, I received your surveys, and I noticed that there was a very different type of background that you guys went through. Like some of you, a lot of you did not take any economics courses. A lot of you took econ in high school. A lot of you, there was, I think, 1 or 2 people that mentioned taking AP microecon, macroecon, which is perfectly fine. And like even some people who took principle of microecon or macroecon, which is also fine. But what they tell you in those basic introductory economics courses, like you can actually boil those messages down into 3 things. One being markets. Markets are the most efficient way to allocate goods in the sense that the transactions are voluntary and the transactions maximizes the sums of utilities of individuals involved in those trade. It doesn't say anything about distribution, which is something that I'm going to get back to later on. Another key messages from this is that individuals are rational in the sense that they can make the decisions that benefits them making use of all of the information that they can use, i.e. they can make the best cost-benefit analysis given all the information, and then they can process all the information, and then there's no need to actually intervene in that dimension. And if the first 2 assumptions are satisfied, we really, what the classical economics textbooks say is that we don't really need a government, but then there are many cases where the first 2 assumptions are not satisfied, and that's when that's when you want to have some level of government intervention. And government intervenes in cases where market failure exists. That's when, in general, one of these 2 conditions or both of them are not satisfied. Governments can intervene in cases where they deal with policies that have large spillovers, like fiscal policies, like what do you do with taxes, like 재난지원금, for instance, and what do you do with monetary policies, like how much money supply do you want in your society right now, for instance. Central bank, you have central banks deciding what your key interest rate will be, which has different names across countries, but almost all central banks regularly have a meeting, like once a month or once every quarter, to determine what that interest rate would be, and that's going to determine how much money supply is out there, and that's going to determine the inflation rates and whatnot. So most debates in economics, if it happens, maybe not in PETA, but if you go outside of PETA, like worlds, they're going to talk about like one of the 3 things. Either they're going to talk about whether the markets are functioning well. Another key contention in economics will be, can you trust individuals to make the right decisions? Because sometimes it's probably not going to happen. And then the third and probably the most important, is the government intervention necessary, and is the government intervention successful? Those are the key contentions that's going to appear in debates about economics if it pops up anywhere. So what I'm going to do is to give you some critical aspects on how you can answer these 3 questions and a little bit more. So at the end of this day, what I want you guys to understand, even if you don't understand fully, one thing that I'm not going to do in this lecture is to deliver you a technical aspects of a particular fiscal or monetary policies, because in a 50-minute lecture you can't do that. What I'm going to do instead is to give you a general perspective on what you can do and how you can actually organize your thoughts and how you can organize any information you see about economics in, let's say, textbooks or The Economist or The New York Times or whatever. I'm going to give you a general guideline on so how you can actually organize those informations, but not necessarily the technical details. So first thing to take away, never take market and rational calculus as given, because if the markets are perfectly competitive, i.e. you have free competition everywhere, nobody has an absolute advantage over the other, then that's probably not a problem, but in reality, that cases are very, very rare. So markets are probably not going to be competitive, and the equal information that I said everybody has, that also may not be the case, and that also has large implications for how fair or how effective the transaction is going to be. That is also going to be the condition that I'm going to cover. And we talked a lot about, let's say, in debates, you may end up using a lot of arguments related to rational calculus of individuals. You can actually trust individuals to make decisions. Maybe that's not even the case. That's also going to be something that I'm going to cover. Second big message that I want you guys to take away is the debates on the degree of government intervention. Degree in the sense that, do you want the government to intervene to begin with? That's contention number one. And if they intervene, do they make things better or worse? And how much should they intervene through what method? That's another thing that I'm going to cover. So I'm going to talk about general tips in policy settings and general tips to assess whether the policy set by the government is actually a good one. And third is a little bit of an extra that slightly deviates away from economics, but more of a logic. This is actually why I mentioned econometrics in the survey. So ultimately, if you can't get at the first two messages, what I really want you guys to take away is the third one. Making reverse causal relationship is challenging. And I think you probably felt that if you tried to answer the last question in the survey that I made, the COVID experiment. So basically, causal relationship isn't just about making chain of events or comparing two different outcomes. Those are only part of it. I'm going to get to mention why that's the case. And what you need to ultimately do to make a causal argument is to find out what the hidden factors are that drive the logical relationship that you are trying to mention. All right, so those are the three parts that I'm going to talk about today. So first thing I'm going to talk about is why do you want to question markets, market structure in particular, and is there a case where you need to question the rationality of individuals? So firstly, the textbook case of markets. In an ideal world, markets are perfectly competitive in the sense that there are infinite numbers of sellers, plethora of sellers, each one of them not having enough power to, say, dictate what the price will be in the market. So in other words, there's no sellers in the market that actually dominates the other sellers. And there's no seller that actually overpowers buyers, because in textbook, what happens is if you set prices slightly higher, the consumers are going to go to somebody else. So that's why in an ideal world, nobody has an asymmetric power over the other entities. Again, that's also a very, very rare case. In fact, you give me an example of any market, chances are you'll probably run into either monopoly or oligopoly or any sort of situations where there is some seller that has slightly higher market power than the others. So a definition of these two might be in order. In Korean, there or it refers to how many numbers of sellers exist in the market. So in monopoly, you have one. In oligopoly, you have like not too much, usually 2 to 5. So if you haven't graduated from high school that long ago, think about school uniforms. And And the problem with having these types of sellers is that they can practically get away by selling something slightly higher than they would have in competitive markets, and there's not much consumers can do about it, because simply because if it's a monopoly, for instance, and that monopoly charges you something slightly higher, consumers don't really have that much alternative. Therefore, that's limiting the consumer's choice, and the consumer's benefit is wiped away because this consumer now has to pay a higher price for something that maybe he or she would have got if the market was competitive. So this you might be able to think pretty easily. There's something that you can actually make the impact of monopolies and oligopolies a little bit worse, in the sense that the first two points are talking about what happens in one time. The last is talking about how those harms can perpetuate, because the markets don't just last today. They're going to last for some considerable amount of time. And what happens when somebody holds up that market power for considerable amount of time is that the potential new entrants are scared away from entering that power market. For instance, if you're a monopolist and you think there might be a new coming firm that wants to enter into your market, there are things you can do. One of them is predatory pricing, where the monopolist firm temporarily drives down the price of its products down for some amount of time. What that does, it gives a potential new entrant a message that, hey, if you enter the market, this is the price that you will have to compete with. And if the prices are low, the chance of you reaping a significant portion of the profits is low. So it's not worth it for you to enter this market. And then it potentially scares away new entrants. You can actually do something like this with other methods, like maybe this monopolist suddenly starts investing a huge amount, also driving this prices down further, and then drives away the potential new entrant. So this is how the monopoly can go on in cycles. And this is how the vicious harms of consumers losing out can actually perpetuate. So I actually judged a lot of debates in monopolies before. Unfortunately, this aspect seems to not get as much attention as the impacts that the consumers have to go through. But this is probably even more powerful than that. Now, second thing that you want to question about markets is about the information. Like, not everybody might have the same information about the product. For instance, think about any markets for used cars or used products. Like, presumably the sellers know more about a used car. Like, if it was his or her own car before, maybe this guy knows that he drove his car into some accidents. But if this guy doesn't tell the potential buyer that this car ran into like 5 accidents or 7 accidents, there's no way for the potential buyer to know that. So, and what that does is the buyer cannot take into account that there was 7 accidents to this car, and that probably had a negative impact on how the car functions, and this buyer's not going to know that. So that relates to the hidden information related to the type of service. There is also another dimension of hidden information, and that happens after transactions. For instance, if you're talking about insurances, or let's say fire insurance, and you know that you're going to be covered, chances are whoever has that insurance might be a little bit less cautious than before, knowing that somebody's going to cover for that action. So the first situation about used cars is called adverse selection. Second situation that I mentioned about insurance is called moral hazard. One of the frequent misconceptions in KIDA is that people refer to simply immoral acts as moral hazard. Again, they're two clearly different terms. Although I gave up correcting those mistakes ages ago, but they're definitely different. So whenever you're trying to call something morally repugnant, don't call it moral hazard. Call it what it is. Just say moral, please, okay? And the consequences of these two is that if you go back to that used car example that I gave you, buyers are going to be afraid, right? Because if the buyers are aware that there's a chance that the seller is probably not being entirely truthful about the functionality of the car or the past histories of that car, you're not going to trust that seller, and then you're probably going to be scared away from getting into transactions with that particular seller. And key debates that will probably run along these two principles is anything that involves medical services or insurances. Because insurances are also very, very subject to these type of errors. I talked about an example of moral hazard. An example of an adverse selection in insurances is it's the other way around. So somebody who wants to buy that insurance knows more about his or her health conditions, right? And if this person decides to hide that information, chances are the seller is probably going to have a difficult time trying to get that information out of it. So if you need to use these two principles, you might be able to be used in debates related to, say, insurances or medical services. Another thing is public goods. And I'm being a little bit loose with the definition of public goods here, because in classic textbooks, it refers to a specific type of goods provided by the public that satisfies So usually public goods refer to goods that in a particular case where consumers are not necessarily in competition, in the sense that if me using a policing service doesn't deprive away policing services available for others. But I am going a little bit general in this lecture, and I'm going to define public goods as provided by the government, and it still is okay and actually in the debating context. And usually those goods are very, very necessary, but sometimes markets alone may not be able to provide enough of it. Things like national defense, policing, roads, or subways, if you did the survey. And the reason that happens is related to this particular concept here called externality. Now, usually what happens is, what's your name, by the way? Okay, if Yeju and I get into some sort of transactions, normally what happens is, we only consider about ourselves. We don't know, normally we don't care about what's going to happen to Hosam, because at the moment he is an outsider. But there are some type of transactions that Hosam can be affected one way or another, but that us two don't really take into account. That's referred to as externality. And then it generally refers to any transaction that includes unintended third party harms or benefits. Now for public goods, it's usually unintended benefits, because a lot of us get benefits from national defense, thank you, or policing. But we don't necessarily pay for them, at least explicitly. There's also an example of unintended third-party harm, and that's pollution, for instance. Whoever is in charge of factory probably cares about minimizing the cost of processing industrial waste, but rarely takes into account what that activity does to the community or maybe the country. So that's a case of unintended third-party harms. Now, public good is usually an unintended third-party benefit case, and what that happens is even those who contribute little can get almost full benefits from that public good. So there is an incentive to free ride in that case, like some people at a particular group projects in universities. And what happens if people start to free ride is that private firms are discouraged from providing them. Because what happens is, if people start to free ride, they're probably not going to contribute to like providing the cost of making those public goods. And private firms on almost all cases, rely on making profits out of them. If they know that there are free riders, they don't reap as much benefits out from them. And they tend to underproduce those types of goods. So that's another possible market failures. And the last thing I want to talk about market structure is about distribution. How was that?
A quick question about public goods. So when it comes to public-private partnerships, do you see a minor version of the underproduction that occurs because it's not fully privatized? Or are those impacts like mitigated overall?
That depends on the share of role that the private or public government has. Like if
You know,
maybe the government's there to like subsidize the cost,
mm-hmm.
or it also depends on if the government is the main producer, but maybe they have a private contract for doing it. So it's actually a case by case answer.
Okay.
But that's definitely something that you might want to study. About distribution, when I talked about economics on the first slide, I said markets are efficient. But at the same time, what I said is they really don't say anything about how the maximized utility is distributed across different individuals. And that could be a problem, because what that means is if the efficient allocation implies that somebody gets none of the goods or none of the products, there's nothing efficiency can say against that. So that's why you need to have another point of view in terms of distribution. And the key takeaway is that it is a completely separate question from efficiency. And one way where this question will pop up in debates is, should we be worried about what type of inequalities, or should we be worried about inequality at all? And if we need to worry about them, how are we going to address those inequalities? Right. That's it for rethinking markets. Now let's think about rational thought processes. So the first question you can ask is, are rational outcomes usually good? Well, they're usually good, but there are noticeable cases where the answer to that question is a no. And that's the case where individual rational outcomes can clash with socially or globally or generally desirable results. So two cases. Firstly, collusion is where, let's say Chongbin and I are selling school uniforms. And then for our profit maximization, we decided to jack the price higher. Like, how much is a school uniform these days? Like, let's say you're selling one set of school uniforms at 300K1, which was like $300. Still freaking expensive for clothes. So that could probably maximize the benefits for Chongbin and myself. But then say if Hozan needs to buy a school uniform for himself or whatever, what happens is that he's forced to pay that high price, and it's not just him, it's whoever needs that school uniform. So what happens is the profit maximizing behaviors of myself and Jopian happens to be at the expense of consumers, which is individually rational between us two. But if you look at it in a social perspective, that probably isn't the case. another example, not necessarily from economics, arms race. So you have country A and country B who's in conflict, and then they decide to arm itself increasingly in a sequential manner. Like, for instance, if A, country A brings in 7 nuclear arsenals, country B responds by bringing in 13, then country A gets back hit by building 21, whatever. So individual, those two countries may or may not feel safe because they're better prepared for war, apparently. But then if you look at like other countries or globally, there is probably an increased probability of war, and then that's where you can actually throw in mutually assured destruction into this debate. But there will be cases where you can argue that there's going to be a peace. So individually rational in the sense that these two countries get better protections, but if you look at it not just in the perspective of these two countries but other countries involved, maybe they don't feel safe as before. So individually rational decisions leading to a negative effects on general population, if that makes much sense. Now, another dimension that I want you to think about is that rational decisions may be based on misinformation, as in maybe they got an imperfect source of information, maybe they brought in wrong reference group. So when I asked that first question about should he allow that smoker to smoke as he or she wants, I've seen you, some of you mentioned that maybe the source he was judging, making the judgments on were probably imperfect. I think someone mentioned advertisements or whatever movies that make smoking look cool. Maybe it would probably, there could be cases where you can actually package those informations as imperfect source of information. And there, as such, what happens is individuals usually fail to make use of all potential sources of information, and which leads them to miss out on what the best possible option could be. Now, we can go a little bit deeper with rationality by questioning our own rationality, right? And for a decision maker to be rational, what the economics say is that they can compare all available options. You can actually make an equal ranking. You can prefer one thing over the other. The key point is you can make a clear statement about it. So for instance, if it's between Americano and latte, or Americano or cappuccino, let's say, you might like both of them equally, you might like one over the other, but you can make clear statements. And that was about ranking them. And you can actually rank them in a consistent manner. If you like Americanos in summer, you'll probably like them in winter. But if you think about it this way, we are more often irrational than we think. And that's because coming up with a decision itself is costly. So sometimes you might actually want to avoid that altogether. And this also explains why people generally stick to status quo. It's actually called status quo bias. And I think this probably happens to quite a lot of us. If you go to any ice cream parlor like Baskin Robbins, where they have like a plethora of menus available, a lot of us probably take a lot of time coming up with a final decision on what flavor we are going to eat. And there's actually a behavioral economics paper that actually deals with this, and it actually, the key message of that paper is it is actually possible to suffer from too much choice. And the last two refers in general to how the decisions are framed, which can also be used in, believe it or not, I think you've probably heard it, media debates or any debate involves changing narratives in conservative societies, or changing narratives or changing like social norms in general. Because what the key takeaway is that your choices might be manipulable to gimmicks such as advertisements or false messages, or your choices can be influenced by things other than the decision itself, like culture, narratives, or identity, which makes decisions to go against social construct much more difficult, even if going against the social norm is the best way forward. So what I usually say is, if you're trying to bring up an argument based on marketplace of idea in a conservative setting, good luck running that argument, because if somebody mentions this, well, the marketplace of ideas is probably would be broken up a little bit easily than it does in other debates. So, recapping the first section, most of the debates are going to involve curbing the market power or putting markets versus government. The key takeaway is that never argue that one of the two entities are perfect, because they simply aren't. I'm going to talk about why government is faulty later on. And then, given that you want to identify what standards you're going to use in judging which one of the actors are better off. And they could be, for instance, you might want to put weight on efficiency, or you might want to put weight on distribution, or another thing you could do is, which one of the two entities gave you something much more closer to something socially desirable? Now, as far as rationality is concerned, this is related to how you actually characterize the stakeholders. If you are in a case where you have to stand in favor of rationality, your gist of characterization should be, people can make well-informed decisions and people can separate irrelevant information in their decision making. If you're arguing against, things that you want to stress out in particular is that you want to emphasize that people, maybe explicitly sometimes or implicitly, are influenced by irrelevant factors such as narratives, such as gimmicks, like false advertisement. Yeah,
so like on that, so earlier we talked about an example of like, or one of the problems of rationality is being like missing, just having the wrong information. So when someone makes like a rational decision based on misinformation, would we categorize that as a rational choice or an irrational choice?
Irrational. You would usually want to, that depends on framing, but
okay.
If that individual thought that information was correct,
mm-hmm.
maybe that individual was being individual, thinking that he was being individual himself,
mm-hmm.
but ultimately what happens is, maybe that was not necessarily the right information to judge upon, so you would want to say, turn that possible case to claim the idea that, oh, individually rational decisions may not necessarily be perfect.
Okay, so would a good angle for like arguing against rationality be based off on like information access? Would that be like a good way of responding?
Information
to
access would usually a good way to go.
Okay.
Or rather than access, you might want to talk about credibility.
Okay. Yeah.
So that was about markets of rationality. Now we talk about governments. And earlier in the discussion, we talked about how markets can be imperfect and this being a case where government is justified in making interventions. And there are several ways in which they can. They can directly make regulations, like in order to prevent certain sellers from having an asymmetrical influence. They can be responsible for providing public goods. As I said, private firms may not necessarily be entirely interested in public interest if it goes against their profit-making schemes. They can do through tax and subsidies. And what they do is that they change the cost structure of the decisions made by the individual firms. So going back to the example that Hep goes on, to as individual transaction. So if, for instance, government taxes us too, if, for instance, Hosan gets hurt in whatever ways, then maybe even within us too, maybe there's an incentive to actually change the decision-making process. And obviously, governments are also responsible for a lot of distribution of income in particular, or distribution of any sort of social benefits, usually done through welfare programs. And that's one of the things that the governments do. Another thing that the government can do is not only to just correct market failures, but they can also step in to stabilize the economy. Like, if the economy is volatile, you want somebody to step in and actually smooth those volatilities, like now maybe. So, and they can do it through two ways. One being fiscal policy, meaning that you're carrying out some sort of welfare programs or any sort of government-run programs based on taxes, like the emergency fund that they're giving out right now globally.
Mm-hmm.
That's coming out straight from the taxes, so that's one of them. And usually the intention is to provide some sort of safety nets. Another is monetary policy, the central bank interest-free policy that I talked about, which impacts prices and impacts how we are going to save and how we are going to not save, depending on what the interest rates would be. And that also has some implications about how we distribute income across time. Maybe you want to save for later, maybe given that the interest rate is so low these days, the best thing to do is probably to spend the money now. So that sort of distribution is what the monetary policy can impact. So given that, can the government solve all the problems? Obvious answer, given that I tend to do that, nobody's perfect. The answer to that is a no, because maybe the monopolies arise out of choice of consumers. Maybe the consumers like one particular firm so much, and then they decide that they're the reason that the other firms are out of the market. Another reason that the monopolies do exist is excessive installment costs, in the sense that if you have multiple firms building, say, electrical grids or water pipelines, initial installation cost is usually very, very huge for these projects, that if you split PE firms if you let like more than one firm take care of it, chances are nobody's going to actually get any benefits out of it. So if you look at most countries, even in Korea for instance, there's like one public company that provides electricity, that provides water, that provides nuclear powers, things like that. And another thing, governments are usually not tethered like market competition or profit maximization. Sometimes good because it also gives them some leeway to care about public interest, but sometimes bad because it actually justifies some inefficient practices like red tape, bureaucracy, and whatnot. And also, while taxes and subsidies do help alter private motives, it is also imperfect in the sense that the way governments decide who to tax, the way government decides who to subsidize, isn't necessarily based on economics, but it sometimes is based on politics, depending on which industry lobbies them the most, and that doesn't really help them economically. And sometimes taxes and subsidies may not fully repair for those possible market failures. And then lastly, government regulation has its own problems, in the sense that governments are run by humans, so simply they don't know everything, maybe and they're not, unless they're directly involved in a particular market project, maybe there's a private entity that knows better. And then decision processes take very, very long to materialize. This is especially the case for fiscal policy, because it has to go through Congress or national assemblies, and that also takes a lot of time. And then, at a worst case, government probably has its own interests, which is separate from the public. Frequently observed in authoritarian governments, also observable in democracies if what if the governments or what the governments care about is probability of being elected, and maybe they will prioritize somebody who would elect them the most rather than the general public itself. And then a few words about designing a public policy is you always want to identify what your goal is. What are you trying to aim to achieve? Are you trying to address some sort of inequality? Are you trying to facilitate slash discourage a particular activity through taxation, through subsidies, or whatnot? Another dimension of policy that's important but frequently misses out in the debates, who are you targeting? So you can target an entire population, like this emergency fund, or you can target a very, very specific population. Now, if you're going for a very, very specific group of population, what you want to be clear with is, why do you want to target that population in the first place? And in order to answer that question much more in detail, one thing that helps you is, how are they different in what dimension is really related to other groups in the population? And given that, what is the result that you expect for these particular group? Are you, for instance, expecting these groups to be in a little bit more equalized setting after the policy? Or if you're trying to facilitate a particular research and development project, or a particular group of people, how are these people different from others? How are these people more smarter than the other group, and how they're going to get much more benefit than the other groups? Now, if you're targeting an entire population, obviously not everybody in the population is the same, so there's going to be a very, very different reaction to it. What you need to do is, why allowing for that difference is okay? Because if you're providing an emergency fund to everyone in the population, there's probably some people who can live without it, and there's probably people that need those emergency funds more than others. So your goal, if you're targeting an entire population, is given those differences, why that's still okay to move forward. So I mentioned universal basic income, but that was because I made this slide a little bit long ago, before the emergency relief fund was materialized in Korea. But yeah, that emergency fund actually belongs to this example too. So that's it for the government. Next thing on the agenda is causality. And let's have a little bit of fun here. Chocolates and Nobel Prizes. Somebody found a positive correlation on it. And so the reason I came up with this one, I told you I study at Columbia, right? Another thing that I do is to be a teaching assistant to economic undergrads. And one of the exercises that we did in an econometrics class is to run a data regression on chocolates and the number of Nobel Prizes in the country. And surprisingly, it came out positive. There was a positive correlation. I thought that was a joke that the professors made to have fun. It was in that paper, which is called New England Journal of Medicine, and it's one of the most highly cited articles in the world. Like, it's cited by doctors in Severance Hospital or SMU Hospital or any college-run hospitals who's trying to find a new method of treatment, and whatever treatment is mentioned there, it's usually credible. Now, this was not like a full article, this was just like a note, but still, if it's going to make that high of an article, it's usually very, very rigorous. So apparently this researcher found a very, very high correlation between these two. And if a correlation is that high, it's very, very correlated. And this researcher tried to find a possible cause behind this. One possible cause was this substance called flavonoids, which apparently stimulates cognitive activities in the brain. But for flavonoids to actually be behind this, what you should expect is you should probably see a similar relationship between Nobel Prizes and whichever things that contain a lot of flavonoids, TNY. But unfortunately, they did not have the same correlation. In fact, what another researcher found was that, believe it or not, I had a lot of fun reading that paper. It had a higher correlation with number of IKEA stores in the country. So, which goes to tell you that trusting correlations alone is a pretty bogus idea. Also, another researcher did something on this and found out that both chocolate consumption and both Nobel Prizes are correlated highly with GDP per capita in the country. They didn't do it for IKEA, but I'm suspecting that this is going to be pretty safe too. In fact, I actually got the data from the paper and then I actually ran it in regression. I don't have it on the slides, but I actually found something similar, which drove me crazy for a couple of hours. So, key takeaway is that causation is very, very tricky to argue, and it's definitely not just correlation. So you want to approach this particular relation with caution. So then what is causality? Well, I'm going to mention a few things that are not causality. One is simple correlation, because things can be correlated due to reverse causality, or a third factor. That chocolate and Nobel Prize example falls into this one. They are mutually correlated with high GDP, but maybe there is no direct causation between chocolates and Nobel Prizes. Well, that could happen. Another thing causation is not, is a sequence of events, because there is a problem of replicability in a different setting. So for instance, Korea tested a lot of people, and therefore maybe they have a small number of people who came up with infections. Is that replicable in other countries or other settings? That probably may or may not be the case. And another thing that causation is not, is simple difference in outcomes between two different entities, specifically entities that are treated, entities that are not treated. Because if there's something else that is different between the two groups, other than the fact that one group got treated and the other group didn't, maybe there's a potential driver of differences coming from that unobserved difference other than the treatment itself. And there's also a difference even within the same group of people that got treated and the same group of people that got untreated. So ideally what we want to argue as a causation is a difference in outcome for the exact same subject before and after treatment. So for instance, if you want to test an effect of a particular drug, you want to clone Hosan, give one of them the drug, not give one of them the drug, and then see what happens. So that's speaking to the principle of other things are equal, or ceteris paribus if you read Mankiw, first chapter, if he still says that after all these years. So that speaks to other things equal, only difference being one got treated, the other didn't. But there's a very, very fundamental problem. I had to clone Hosan to make that possible, but cloning is impossible right now. So that's not just for this particular case, but that runs through every single one of them, in the sense that you can't treat and untreat same subject at the same time, same individual at the same time. So we really can't argue causality fully, but we can get reasonably close. And that's where a natural experiment framework comes in. So, and a definition of that is a particular event. It can be either a result of a design, like a particular policy, or it can be an accident, like a natural disaster. But what it does is it satisfies these two criteria. Firstly, it has to separate those who are clearly affected and those who are unaffected, treatment or untreated, treatment versus untreated. Another thing it should satisfy is that for everything else except the treatment, and these two groups are similar in other dimensions. Like, the two groups have the same age composition, the two groups have the same proportion of people who have underlying treatment, underlying diseases or not. That I'm speaking about the last question in your survey. That was the intention. So this is kind of a loose general definition of a natural experiment framework that helps you guide to making a causal argument. Even if it doesn't help you make an argument itself, what it can do is to provide standards for evaluating whether something is causal, and also help you assess a particular effect of a policy. So for instance, if you want to test a policy of testing particular groups of people for COVID-19, and you want to argue that testing helped to prevent spread of COVID-19, what you may want to see is this just testing alone, or is there something else that's driving the differences? For instance, it could be the case that the testing fee itself is practically, well, not exactly zero, although I was tested for zero cost when I was in quarantine myself after returning from the United States. But if you want to get tested in the United States and if you don't have an insurance, the cost skyrockets to $3,000 in New York.
Yeah.
I don't know about other states, but at least in New York it's like that. So what happens is people are unwilling or unable to get tested, unfortunately, even though, because the size of the population in the United States is pretty large, the testing number and the test in terms of proportion is, I think, slightly higher than Korea right now, but things, infection is still going on over there, unfortunately. So maybe the key takeaway is that it's probably not just testing, but it's something else that actually drives these results. That you might want to use this framework as a guide to actually be able to assess that. And you can also talk about, given that you want to target your policies, if you're targeting to a limited group of people, to the subgroup of population that's going to benefit the most, are you actually targeting that group? You can actually use this framework to actually come up with the tools to assess whether that is actually happening. And then you can actually use another usage of natural experiment framework is to give you tools to rebut some of your opponent's arguments. And then these are the frequent deviations from natural experiment. One is an omitted factor, i.e. maybe something else other than the event or treatment itself is driving the results, like for instance maybe the testing fee in the example that I just mentioned. Maybe there is a selection bias, i.e. the people who are affected, people who are unaffected, differ in some unobserved dimensions. You can actually use the selection bias argument, not just in this case, but as an argument in debates related to representability in democratic setups. Another deviation, heterogeneity of subjects, that speaks to the differences within the same group. So for instance, if you're talking about affirmative action policy towards a disadvantaged group of populations, they are not the same. Maybe there are different characteristics even within the disadvantaged populations, and you might want to look out for that too. Another deviation, contextual dependence, i.e. the same sequence of events does not get replicated in a different setting. And if that happens, maybe this sequence of events you mentioned is not the full cause of, not the full event that drives your causal result, but maybe there's something else that's hidden within these different contexts that's actually driving the results. Another is something that I call general equilibrium effect. What that is if you're running a particular event several times, chances are individuals may have learned about what that event is, and maybe they adjust their reaction to an event accordingly. So over the long period of time, maybe the effects of policy or effects of a particular event may be wiped away because of it. And again, to make use of that, you can use that to construct rebuttals. Especially for British parliamentary format, if you learn about that, you can actually use that to preempt rebuttals from, so if you want to say, if you're an OG, you might want to preempt a particular rebuttal from CO by making said, oh, CO might come with this and this and this, but we can rebut to that by whatever. You can actually use that framework in this way. And we're almost done. So the key takeaway is that you can actually, economics do yield useful tricks about firstly how markets work and how they fail. Secondly, about how rational calculus is not absolute. Third, how it gives you a guidance about what the government role is and how it can malfunction at the same time. And then lastly, it can give us a guide to as to what the, it's probably not going to give an exact causality, but it's going to help us get reasonable clips. And if you don't understand this in your first try, that's perfectly fine. But I highly recommend you to conduct this material, or if you need a textbook reference, I've studied econ for more than 10 years now, so I have a bunch of economics textbooks that's in my room that I haven't referred to for years. So you can actually ask for sources, and I can answer questions for you.
Yep.
And if I'm going to give this version to either Sokol or Yum. And this link is actually active. So if you click this email address, you can actually send me an email. Right? So you can ask any questions. There's one question that I don't want you to ask, and it's about stock markets. That's why I have this picture. Right? That's it for the lecture, and if you have questions, please talk to me.